Aloha class! Today we're going to talk about this amazing story of vertebrate evolution in the lungs. So we have, really a long time ago, we had the evolution of buccal pumps, and this occurred before animals, while animals were still fish, or I guess the vertebrate evolution, you know, was still, there were still only fish on this planet. And then as other animals evolved and went on to land, we have the evolution of the expiration pump and the aspiration pump. Okay, so the buccal pump is a pump that is in the throat. And so that works by having the animal open its mouth and it expands its buccal cavity or throat, and that draws air in, and at the same time, when the animal is also opening its glottis and allowing the air that's already in the lungs to escape, and so that mixes. Okay, so that's the expiration. Well, it's sort of expiration and inspiration. And then the animal closes its mouth and squeezes. It constricts the branchial muscles or the buccal cavity, and that forces air down into the lungs. It's a mix of fresh and expired air. Okay, so then the lung is pressurized and it's absorbing oxygen. The next time the animal comes up again the elastic recoil will cause expiration, and then expansion of that's preceded by expansion of the buccal cavity to draw the air in. Amphibians also have a buccal pump, and it basically is operating by the same principle. So at first the glottis is closed, inspiration with the buccal pump draws air in, then the glottis opens and air can come out, and then the nares closes, and then the air is forced into the lungs by the buccal pump. And here is a really cool video of a giant salamander breathing, and you can see the buccal pumping going on right here. Pretty cool, huh? And it's pushing some air into the lung here. So you can see this because this is an X-ray video. Then we have the evolution of reptiles, and they have lungs with more structure. So most lizards have what's called a unicameral lung, which is a single cavity lung. And this is a typical lizard lung in a lacerated lizard. Now, monitor lizards, which are a group of more active lizards, you know, varanids and monitors, have what's really cool looking in a different way. It's a multicameral lung. So there are multiple compartments in this lung. And so it's believed that this structure is an aid to increasing surface area and allowing it to support a higher metabolic rate that these animals have. But both of these lungs have tracheal reinforcement so that we don't have collapsing of the lungs, of the airways anyway. Okay, then we have the evolution of mammals and birds, and they have all three groups, mammals, reptiles, and birds, have the intercostal suction pump. So it's intercostal because costal bones are ribs, and intercostal means that these muscles go between the ribs, and when they constrict, they move the rib cage up and down, and when that happens, the lungs expand. Okay, so all three groups, birds, reptiles, and mammals, have this. They have the intercostal suction pump, but only mammals and birds also, but independently derived, have a diaphragm. So that's a muscle that is sitting on underneath the lungs, and it separates the lower abdomen from the upper thoracic cavity. And when that muscle constricts, it pulls down, expanding the lungs, causing negative pressure that draws the air in. Okay. Here is a monitor lizard with some sound effects added. So I want you to see that there is buccal pumping going on here in the throat. Okay. And it's, so there's a really cool story with this. So some really smart people, one of my friends actually, proposed this hypothesis that lizards, which only have the axial intercostal pump, right, the rib cage, they don't have a diaphragm. So therefore, he said, how do they breathe while they're running? Because when you're running, you're contracting your axial musculature on opposite sides. You know, you're doing right leg, left leg, right leg, left leg. So that's alternating. But breathing requires you to move your ribs simultaneously, right? Both sides have to expand and contract. So since this is the only mechanism for lizards, there's a constraint. So he said that lizards cannot run fast and breathe at the same time. And sure enough, when he ran iguanas, he ran other lizards, he saw that they stopped breathing. When they run, they stop breathing. Pretty cool. But what about monitor lizards? They have higher metabolic rate. How do they sustain that? And they can walk pretty fast for long periods of time. So when you see this video, you can see, so this is some other friends, and you see they supplement their breathing with this buccal pumping action. So they're able to maintain aerobic respiration at a little bit higher level of activity because they're supplementing it with buccal pumping. And this is the work of Beth Brainerd and some colleagues, because they were wondering, what about monitor lizards? Pretty cool, huh? Okay, then we have crocodiles, which are really, really amazing. They're so weird because they do not have a mammalian diaphragm. But sometimes they can really put out some bursts of energy, okay? What they have, though, is what's called a diaphragmatic muscle. And it's attached to, you'll never believe it, but it's attached to the liver, okay? So the liver is what they use to expand and contract their lungs. Well, mainly to expand their lungs. And what they do is, when they want to take a huge deep breath, they will contract that diaphragmatic muscle, which will pull the liver back, causing the lungs to expand. Pretty cool, huh? And then, of course, when they want the liver to return, then they contract their abdominal muscles, which will serve to lengthen those diaphragmatic muscles again. So here is a video. Look at that. Look at this liver moving. Isn't that freaky? So you want to take a deep breath? Move your liver. It's also doing some buccal pumping too. It's pretty primitive. So look at that. Pretty crazy. Okay, here, take a look. Oops. Okay. Never mind. So then we have birds, which are like kind of the pinnacle of weird lung evolution in vertebrates. So, of course, they have this hinge, this thoracic hinge, so they can really expand their thoracic cavity and so get lots of that intercostal pump, suction pumping going. But what they have is a series of air sacs. These are not lungs, so these are air sacs, and there's like five of them. The lungs are in these little tubes called the parabronchi, and they're kind of dorsally located. So inside the tubes, air flows in only one direction. So they have the only system in terrestrial vertebrates of unidirectional airflow. Totally crazy, huh? So it flows one way through these tubes or these parabronchi, and that's when gas exchange occurs with the air capillaries. So if you look at this these four diagrams in the corner here, this describes the mechanism. Okay, well, I'll go through it with the next set of figures. So it only shows two air sacs, but it's because even though there's five, you can just model it as two, basically the posterior air sacs and the anterior, or the ones closer to the head. So let's go. So to go all the way around the system from inspiration to final expiration, it requires two respiratory cycles, okay? So on the first breath, the first inspiration, air, there's a valve that's closed and the air just goes straight back to the posterior air sacs. So that's inspiration one. Expiration one pushes the air into the lungs. Then inspiration two draws air out of the lungs and into the anterior air sacs. And then expiration two finally pushes the air out of the air sacs and out into the environment. Okay, so here we go again. Inspiration, expiration, inspiration, expiration. Pretty cool, huh? So it's one way, unidirectional. Remember too that air is always moving all the way through the system at all times. It's just that it's just colored so you can follow one volume of air. But it's a very efficient system. Okay, well that was the story of the pumps. Okay, but of course, the thing that is driving gas into the body, oxygen into the body, is these oxygen partial pressure gradients. Because as you know, it's diffusion, which is all passive. Okay, so because it's passive, it requires a favorable gradient all the way around the circuit. Okay, so here are these flow patterns that we've talked about. In fish, they have countercurrent flow. So that maintains a really optimal gradient between the water and the blood. Avians have this cross current system, which also maintains a very favorable gradient, almost as efficient as fish. And then the least efficient are the typical tidal lungs that mammals and lizards have. And that's a uniform pool. So air is drawn in, mixed with stale air, basically, and then expired. Okay. So when we look at countercurrent gas exchange across the gills, you see here that in the upper right corner that there's a constant gradient of oxygen maintained between the water and the blood. At every, even though the oxygen is going down in the water as it goes across the gill, the blood that it's encountering as it travels down is progressively more and more depleted because the blood is circulating in the opposite direction as the water. So magically, well, it's not magic, it's actually just physical chemistry, but anyway, it's just physics. The gradient is constant all the way across the gill. So that's a hallmark of countercurrent gas exchange, is that the gradient is constant. Okay, so if we look at these various models, basically the open and the pool are pretty similar, but open is referring to skin, whereas the pool is referring to a tidal lung. But anyway, we have air going in, mixing with a pool, and then coming back out. And so if you look at the very bottom here, the upper graph is the oxygen pressure of the medium, which is in this case air, and then the lower graph is the oxygen levels in the capillaries, so from venous to arterial. So as you can see, as the blood is traveling along the lung, it's getting more and more oxygenated. So what that means is the gradient between the blood and the lung is diminishing because the pool is at a constant level of oxygen partial pressure, right? It's just one pool, so it's all the same amount. So if you look at the countercurrent in the fish gill example, you see that because the bloodstream and the water current is traveling in opposite directions, the gradient can be maintained. And that's because the water gradient can change, as opposed to in the pool where it's constant. Okay, sorry, I know that's a little confusing, but anyway, the gradient can be maintained. That's what's really important. With the cross current, it's got this really complex network of capillaries, but what it allows for a similar sort of variation in flow of blood versus water, air, sorry, so that it can almost maintain a constant gradient as the air is traveling through the lung. It's pretty remarkable, almost as efficient as countercurrent gas exchange. So how do you calculate the efficiency? Well, you can just use this simple efficiency equation. Now, anytime you want to know the efficiency of something, you just subtract, okay, starting value minus ending value divided by starting value times 100%. That's efficiency. Okay, so if we have the oxygen partial pressure going in minus the partial pressure coming out divided by the in times 100, there you have it. Okay, so here's three examples. One is for concurrent. Okay, and so you just have to look at the maximum, the in and the out. And so here it's 152. And then the cross current and finally the counter current. And you can see that the counter current is the most efficient of these three. So now the question is, how do you adjust respiration when the animal exercises? How can an animal get much more oxygen when its demands go up? So there's really only two things, there's other things too, but two main things, okay, is it can take more breaths, increase the breath frequency, or it can take bigger breaths, increase the breath volume. Okay, and both of those things multiplied together will give you respiratory minute volume, or the overall amount of breathing per minute. Alveolar minute volume is the amount of air that goes across the alveoli per minute, the gas exchange surfaces. Okay, so this is not oxygen, this is actually just air, how much air is going in and out. And then the alveolar volume is, if you add the dead space or the trachea to the alveolar volume, that total gives you tidal volume. Okay, so if you want to calculate alveolar volume, you just take tidal minus dead space. Anyway, if you times it by breaths per minute, that will give you the minute volume, or the amount of volume per minute. Okay. So here's a bunch of different volumes and breathing states. So there's normal quiet breathing at rest, and then hyperapnea or hyperventilation, and then apnea, which is the absence of breathing. And that sounds really scary, but actually lots of animals do that. Ectotherms do not necessarily breathe regularly. They can have long periods of apnea when they're not really breathing. They can hold their breath a long time. Okay, yeah, they have low metabolic rates. It really gives them a lot of freedom. Anyway, so let's look at this figure on the right here. This gives you an idea of some of the volumes in lungs. So if you go from 0 to 6 liters, that 6 liters is the maximal lung volume that you can have when a human forces themselves to breathe as much as possible. Huge breath, okay? That's the maximum inspiratory volume, total lung volume. So there's always, if you expire your lung as much as you possibly can, that's the maximum expiratory level, okay, down at the bottom, near the bottom. All the way at the bottom would be zero, and that would mean that everything, your lungs and your trachea, everything had collapsed. Okay, that actually never happens in practice. So that difference between the maximum expiratory level and zero is the residual volume. That amount of air is always in your lung, no matter how much you're breathing. Okay, so the red squiggly line is the tidal volume. It's the amount, the volume that you breathe in one breath, in and out like the tide. Okay, so at rest, tidal volume is going to be small. But of course, when you're intensely exercising, that can go way up. And other animals that can do really weird things with tidal volume are, of course, sea mammals, because they dive. There's lots of weird things going on with them. Okay, and then, so there's the tidal volume, there's the dead space volume, there's the alveolar volume. And then for those of you interested in medicine, there's this inspiratory reserve volume. So the difference between the tidal and what you can maximally inspire. And then there's the expiratory reserve volume, or how much at the lower, when you expire during a normal breath versus the maximum expiration you can do. Then there's vital capacity, which is the difference between maximum inspiration and maximum expiration. Vital meaning like in life. So that's the maximum capacity in breathing in life. There's an inspiratory capacity and then a functional residual capacity, yada, yada, yada. You can go on and on and on. But total lung capacity is big and never really used functionally. Okay, that's an anatomical value. But these things are important for you to know, for you to do your homework, and for you to do your projects. So I hope that this was helpful, and see you soon. Take care.